इदमिन्द्रं तं ज्ञानरूपिणे। ओम ओम नारायण। वी हैव टू डिस्कस सुगमा अध्यास भाष्य। बाय मिस्टेक आई ब्रॉट विशुद्ध वेदांत सार। नाउ पुट इट बैक एंड देन अगेन आई ब्रॉट दिस। सो आत्मानात्मनोर इतरेतर अध्यासः, ए मिसअंडरस्टैंडिंग, एन अध्यास बिटवीन दीज टू। वेन वी से बिटवीन दीज टू, वी आर लुकिंग एट देम ओनली इन एन अध्यस्त कंडीशन। इन अध्यस्त कंडीशन आत्मा अनात्मा कैन नॉट बी सीन सेपरेटली। दैट्स वाई वी कॉल इट अध्यास। दैट कॉन्शियसनेस इज नोन। See, we say, I know the consciousness. Simple common man's experience, I say. Oh, just as you know table, you know the wall, you know the book, you know many things, many objects we know. Similarly, I know the consciousness. This is adhyasa. Okay, now you understand. Consciousness is the very knowing principle. How can you say, I know consciousness? I understand consciousness. The very knowing of consciousness in these things, consciousness is okay. That I know it when you say you are making it as an object. Okay. So this very expression that I know consciousness is adhyasa. Isn't it simple? It is very simple and straight. Because consciousness cannot be known. It is the consciousness that knows anything else. And consciousness itself is a not an object of knowing. If you take consciousness to be an object, that means you have imputed, you have ascribed, you have imposed objectness to it. But you say, I have not done anything consciously. True, you have not done anything consciously. But that's what your mind says. When your mind thinks that I know consciousness, that means this very experience, this very thought implies consciousness is objectified. That means objectness, which is object of consciousness, you are putting it as belonging to consciousness, isn't it? Objectness is known to consciousness. It is not the nature of consciousness. What is not the nature of consciousness? It is known to consciousness. That knownness you are including as if pertaining to the consciousness. This is adhyasa. When I say I am so and so, I am conscious, I means consciousness. That consciousness you are presenting as I, referring as I. So that referring as I, as an object of I notion, itself is adhyasa. This is what natural, because consciousness doesn't become an object. Consciousness knows many things. All that which we know is vishaya. But here we are taking consciousness itself is a vishaya. One side we say consciousness, another side we say object. So we are not aware here. You see, I know consciousness. This is adhyasa. Knowing consciousness means you are putting consciousness as an object. But who is conscious of that objectness? Consciousness only. Consciousness knows, and you say, I know the consciousness. Yes, I understood consciousness. So this knowing or understanding means you are putting as an object. You are making it an object. You are treating it, not making. Making means you are treating it as an object. Treating consciousness also as an object. Consciousness knows, but I know consciousness. So that treating consciousness as something known, here is adhyasa. Consciousness, which is naturally the knower, is treated as something to be known. Now the adhyasa, this is called adhyasa. This you have not done anything consciously, but this is how it is. Our experience says there is adhyasa. See how Shankara touches it. He doesn't bring any quotation. any Shruti quotation, any Veda, any Upanishad or any Purana or any Shloka. It just directly points out our Anubhava. In Adhyasa Vasha there is no single quotation. He never brings any quotation. And he feels that it is not required. He just points out what is in our Anubhava, which nobody can deny. Whether atheist, theist, believer, non-believer, boy or girl or aged man or young man, anybody, whoever is capable of seeing can listen, and he finds out. Shankara is pointing out. Therefore, this is a direct Anubhava. Okay, so we were discussing the one thing mistaken for other. One thing mistaken for other means we are not seeing them as a two. We are already in that adhyastha condition, in that mixed condition, adhyastha condition. Their atma, anatma are mutually mistaken. Generally, one side mistake we find. Rope is mistaken for snake. Okay. I don't know whether we can give any example of mutual mistake. I don't know, Shankaracharya also didn't give anything. Swamiji also didn't give. To my knowledge, there is no example for mutual mistake. There is only one side mistake. You mistake rope for snake. In the same misunderstanding, in the same error, do you see that you mistake the snake as a rope? Rope alone is mistaken for snake. Snake is not mistaken for rope. It's only one side mistake. But here our experience is very strange, peculiar, probably unique also. There is nothing other than this. It is our Anubhava is the only unique one. That Atma for Anatma, Anatma for Atma. See, that's a mistake, error. Therefore, in these things also, again a slight difference. One is the very identity of Atma, Anatma. Mistaking the identity of Atma Anatma means Atma Anatma, they don't look like two. That's why the Purapakshi denied that there is no Adhyasa, he says. When Purapakshi told there is no Adhyasa, what he meant is that which we are seeing as this consciousness, that I am conscious of myself, I know myself, this is not a mistake, this is a natural state, he told. What Purapakshi meant is, I know myself, this is a natural state. I have not done any consciously any mistake. I have not picked up anything. He says it is natural because we find it. It is not a, see, if there is a mistake, a few people commit mistakes. But it is so universal in everybody. It is so universal in all human beings. How can you say the whole humanity is under mistake? A few people might be under mistake. Okay. How can you say whole humanity is a mistake? Generally, our modern psychology, modern science, modern society, what they say is, we go by the society. What is prevalent, what is common, we take as a standard. What is rare, we take it as an aberration. Modern psychology goes by this. In fact, all our science is only statistical data only. Most of the scientific research is statistical data. You give this medicine to few people, around 20 people you give them, and keep another 20 people, you don't give them medicine. They kept separately. Watch for 1 week and 10 days. Then you say this change has taken place, therefore this medicine brings about this change, that's all. This is all statistical data. And among the 20 people also whom you have given the medicine, only 18 people or 17 people, 15 people behaved like that. And 5 people behaved differently. Therefore, largely, around 16, 17 people you take them. Okay, majority 80%. Okay, therefore it is process for medicine. All that we do is only data. Statistical data. So similarly, what is commonly seen, you call it as a natural. After few generations, or maybe 1 or 2 generations, 2 generations, a century or so, what you call as a natural doesn't look natural. This becomes a rare, something else becomes a common. Now you say, this is natural. Now you know what they say? It is misunderstanding, they don't say. We misunderstood, they don't say. He says, that was a old science and this is a modern science. According to old science, a particular quality was natural. Now this is natural. What does it mean? You mean natural also changes? What you find in more number of, if suppose there are, everybody is a liar. Most of the people, suppose 75%, 80 people tell lies. Only maybe 20 people out of 100 speak the truth. Now what do you say? Telling lies is natural. Speaking truth is an aberration. There are some misunderstood people. There are some, what you call, mental cases who tell the truth. But telling the lie is natural. Because 80% of people tell lies. This is called modern science and psychology. So, you study the psychology, you will be shocked. You will be shocked really. When I have not read it thoroughly, but just glanced at him and I discussed with psychologists. I was shocked to hear that this is called, you call science, a great science. I tell you, it's a mental case. It is not science. It is a mental case. Because it was started by a mental patient alone. Freud himself is a mental patient. So, what, supposing after some time, earlier you say drinking was considered as unnatural, is a bad habit, is an aberration, is a deviation, isn't it? Now seeing the European American culture, now they say drinking is very good. Everybody drinks at home, they drink. Okay, at home. Now it is normal. Now the more people drink, you say, it is normal. If it doesn't drink, a person who drinks is a sober. One who doesn't drink, he has to be taken to mental hospital and checked. Something is wrong with him. Why does he not drink? Something is wrong. Because drinking is natural. You see, this is the kind of psychology, this is the kind of science we have developed it. And they say science is challenging, science is greater than religion. Now they put Vedanta into religion. Okay. They put Vedanta into religion because only religious people with Shraddha, Bhakti, Sannyasis, with all putting Tilaka, and they study Vedanta. Since religious people study Vedanta, they think that in European religion only fools alone become religious people. Most illogical, emotional, pervert fellows alone are religious people. Because you don't find a logical thinkers as religious people in Europe, in America. Therefore, they think really any sane thinker can be put into philosophy or science. A balanced thinker, a reasonable thinker, a logical thinker should become a philosopher or a scientist. Cannot be a religious man. But in India, philosophy, Vedanta is in religion. Therefore, they say, oh, it is all pervert. Vedanta is a pervert because it is all faith. Aham Brahmasmi is a faith. Isn't it? Vedanta is a faith. Faith means is a belief. Vedanta is a belief because all religions are belief. This is the scientific thinking of modern man. You take one thing, you take one negative example and generalize all religions from the negative example. You see the pervert to terroristic religions. In them, terrorism is common and passiveness and ahimsa, shanti is an exception. Shanti is an exception, aggression is common. And take them as a standard religion and start judging Hinduism, Vedanta and all Upanishads, Puranas and everything, our Shastras, as belief. Therefore, we should follow, India should follow secular, Europe is following secular, we must follow secularism. Keep Vedanta away. Keep children, protect specially from Vedanta because they'll become fanatics. Keep Vedanta away from children. Children should go healthy thinkers. Okay? More people are drinking. Isn't it? More people are non-vegetarians. If somebody vegetarian, they say something is wrong. Something is wrong? Why does he want to be vegetarian? Oh my God. He should be treated urgently. Taken to a psychologist. So if you drink, you are normal. So the standard of right and wrong, that's why the whole language itself is a pervert language. The concept of truth. You know what they say? The Abraham religion, particularly Christianity, what is truth? you believe that becomes a truth. Now if you ask him, is it not belief? You are telling, how can it be truth? Generally when we say truth means what is understood to be truth, what is proven to be a fact, that is a truth. Now how can you say belief is a truth? You believe Jesus, that is a truth. Then I asked him, how can you say it is a truth? It is a belief. Now he said, no, that is truth. I believe it to be true. You know what they say? I believe it to be true. Then you say, somebody just doesn't believe it. It is not true for him. He says, no, you are not believing. That's why you don't know what is truth. You believe, you understand how it is true. That means to understand the truth, you have to believe it. Once you believe, it becomes truth. Now it is proven already. You understand? If you don't believe, it cannot be proven because you have not understood. You believe it. Then once you believe, it is proof. That is a proof. Now the whole language of truth and untruth is spoiled. Whole language, English language of truth and untruth is perverted. So what is commonly more, nowadays they say, so many Christians, so many Muslims all over the world. That means they are the true religions. Hinduism, they are very small minority, and that too getting reduced day by day due to conversions. They are getting reduced. Secularist, Hindus are becoming communist, Hindus are becoming secularists, Hindus are becoming liberals, and then Hindus, in number of Hindus are getting reduced. That means it is untruth. Now what is truth? You propagate, you spread it, that is the truth. So this language is a perversion language. Okay? This is a mental case. It is not the truth. Because it is not a sane language. So therefore, what is commonly seen is a truth? How can you say? Generally, more people have weaknesses. They tell lies. Those who speak truth are really few people. Now therefore, you say telling lies is normal and speaking truth is abnormal. What is the standard? Is this the standard? So, Atma, Anatma, Adhyasa is natural, because it is commonly found. The Purapakshi says, if it is in everybody, how can you call it Adhyasa? It is commonly found in everybody. Mistake means, now you see, this is a blind belief. People think that mistake means only few people should commit mistake. If everybody, majority, 80-90%, 95%, 99% of people think in a particular way, hold a particular view, then it must be true. How can it be wrong? Now they say, we say Vedanta is good, Vedanta is great. They ask you, how many Vedantins are there in India? Now if you go and verify, there will be very few Vedantins. Then how many people take to Vedantic study? Now you have to prove to the world, if there are more Vedantins, more Vedantic students, then Vedanta is a great religion. Otherwise, it is a blind belief. See, this is the modern standard. More number of people should study. Okay. Out of the people, those who study, how many people become really jnanis? There are how many jnanis in the world? Come on, count. Hardly handful. That means Vedanta is a failure. Because hardly minor, micro-minor few people alone, 5 to 10 people, 20 people, in each generation you find Brahmajnanis. Or maybe little more, we don't know, but hardly few people. Purna Nishta. Most of them will be on the way in sadhakas. So, Vedanta, you call it great. What percentage of Vedantins become Jnanis? I think 0.01%. Out of Manushyanam Sahasreshu, Kaschid Yatati Siddhaya. Out of thousands of people, very few people take to Vedanta, Vedantic sadhana, Vedantic study. Out of those people who take to Vedantic sadhana, very few people succeed in becoming jnanis. That means it is not a very successful entrepreneur. See, it is not very successful. It's a very micro-minority success. Very, very, very mild success. But ajnana is more popular, then that must be truth. Isn't it? More people are ajnanis. So that is the truth. So this is the standard we are picking from Europe. Okay? This is the contribution of, great contribution of Europe. And even now we have not given up this thing. Somebody wrote that Einstein was a fool. and he compiled the people's opinion, maybe 30-40 people's opinion, in the form of essays, and he published a book. You know, I'm told, I just read it, I don't know how far it is true, but I just read it, a brief passage. And Einstein said, it seems, after just glancing at the book, he told, if I am wrong, then you don't need the opinion of 30 people, one person would be enough. See, to prove something right or wrong, you don't need so many people. If one person says, if I am wrong, it's enough, wrong is wrong. If I am right, see, it is not how many people say. Our constitution is also another bundle of errors. It is all written by only this kind of people who received education from British, not well versed in our Indian thinking, not aware of Indian society. Most of them are city based, and whether city based or not, they all just copied British and other Europeans' constitution. They thought that India has no existence, which Britishers told, India has no existence. It is a barbaric society. They have to learn everything from Britishers. Our people have just assimilated this so much, they believed that everything has to be brought from England, and whatever England says we should do, then only India will become India. Until then, India is not a country at all. It is not worth living at all. In fact, we also should do everything exactly what England should do. First thing is wearing our Indian shirt of this pancha, this dhoti itself is a wrong thing. We have to wear pant and shirt. Then only we will become Indian. Until then, India is a barbaric. It is barbaric, okay, according to them. So, the standard of right and wrong is how many people follow. Einstein told, a truth can be by verification, by pramana, can be seen. If it is a mistake, you can see it, verify it, by judge it, by a pramana. If it is wrong, even one person proves it to be wrong. But if he proves with authoritatively and shows, demonstrates to everybody convincingly, then it is wrong. Even if one person says it is enough, why do we need 30 people? See, he took it lightly. He did not take it as a prestige, you know. 30 people write a book and do propagating against me. You are doing a propaganda against me. 30 people wrote essays and one published in one volume and propagating, oh, Einstein is wrong. 30 people told. Einstein took it so coolly. And you told, why do you need 30 people to prove me wrong? One person was enough. That shows all 30 people went wrong. One person would be enough. Why do we need 30? So that is wisdom. That is wisdom. So here, Purapakshi says that everybody says I am an individual. Everybody thinks that I know myself. Supposing you don't know yourself, how do you know what you are? See, this is the common sense logic. Tell me what you are. I say, I don't know what I am. That means you are ignorant. You must know what you are. I am so and so. That is knowledge. I am so and so. That is knowledge. Siddhanti says, that exactly is ignorance. If you have some opinion, some idea about you, that is ignorance. If you have some opinion, some idea, some concept of you, that is ignorant, because any conception means objectifying. Atma, which is consciousness, cannot be conceived, because it is consciousness in which all conceptions take place. Okay? It is the consciousness in which all kinds of conceptions take place. And if you conceive Atma, then that is Adhyasa. Whole thing has become ulta. Purapakshi says, I know myself, that means it is a jnanam. Everybody thinks that I know, I am so and so, I am so and so. Then everybody is jnani. Shankara says everybody is a jnani. Everybody is a jnani. Because everybody conceives himself as so and so. Because what is beyond conception, you are putting a conception. And you take it for granted that this is natural. Because everybody thinks like that. If I point out somebody, he says, oh, everybody doesn't think like that. Somebody asked me. Somewhere in an ashram, I went to, and somebody seeing me in Kashaya Klose, I did namaskar, everything, saying, did you write any books? I told, where are you from? I was staying in Hyderabad, and I told, I came from Hyderabad. Oh, then I don't know, his instant question was, what book you published, what book did you write, what book you wrote in? I told, where is the need to write? There are so many books on spirituality already. See, you make use of them and you get a good direction. There are very good books, many books. You study them and understand, that's over. Do I have to add to the market? Just because you keep on adding, what is the point? They say, on the subject, when there is a good book already, where is the need to write? I should become popular, that my name should become popular. You know what he told? I didn't say so many details. I only told simply this thing. When there are already some good books on spirituality and Vedanta, let people read. Where is the need for another book? Where is the need another book from that to from me? You know what he says? Everybody doesn't think like that. He didn't even understand what I told. He didn't even understand what I told. Truth doesn't need repetition. Repetition in the sense, the more people writing the same truth. Truth is truth. So if there is, our traditional method is like that. If there is already one book on Vedanta, you see, this is a very interesting thing. Our Indian conception we need to know, because the Europe has spoiled everything, destroyed everything. If there is already a book, a good book, which is communicating, which is clearly explaining the topic, then there is no need for another book. Nobody should write another book. This is our traditional way. If there is a good book, why do you need to write? You study that and you understand. Your purpose of the book is to help people to understand, gain the knowledge, write knowledge. When there is already one book in the market available, why do you have to write another book? That means your motive is suspicious, to be suspected, because you want to become popular. If your name and fame, your popularity is an overriding desire, naturally your book will be unfit to be read. You know, anarambhaniya dosha, we call in Sanskrit. In the beginning, first shloka, as you are writing Mangalacharana, you have to establish the need of the book for the society. Why do you write? Now first you have to establish the subject is important. Why do you write on the subject? The need of the subject for the society. Do you need that Vedanti Jnanam for the society? First establish it. Then second thing is, are there no books already on this, in the market or in the society? You have to say that this book is not available. Third thing is, what right you have got to write? What right you have got? Just because you want to write and you have got a money and you publish it, and then you have got a market and give them the lot of discount and they'll sell you. They will sell you. Any customer goes to his shop first, because if you give him high discount, high commission to the fellow, any customer comes to the shop, first he will put it in the front. Come on, take it. This is the best book. He himself will advertise and sell it. Then next person comes, he says, oh, this has got a high percentage of sale. Bah, the books are sold out within 1 month. You see high demand. Then you think that, oh, must be a great book, and then you buy. It is a trash. Because he sold it by giving commission to the shopkeeper. Now, three things you have to prove. The subject matter which you are discussing, Atmajnanam. Is Atmajnanam necessary for people? Why and how? Second thing is, supposing Atmajnanam is useful to humanity. Okay. If it is useful, are there no books already? Upanishad is there, Shankara Bhashya is there. When Shankara Bhashya is there, study Shankara Bhashya is over. Where is the need for your book? Is there anything your book going to say something extra? Or you compile from a piece from that book, piece from this book, you rewrite and you represent them and then want to become popular? Why do you want to write another book and spoil the people's minds? Nowadays people took it very hardly. What is this you are talking? I know something and I'll write. I've got every right. I will write. I'll become popular. Then third reason is, why do you want to write? What right you have got? What authority you have got it? Have you studied from Guru? Or have you done sadhana? Or have you got the experience of Brahman? Then three, have you studied from a Guru, from a proper tradition? Have you done that sadhana? Have you understood it correctly? Have you become free from samsara? If you have studied perfectly, correctly, then are you capable of perfectly communicating to others? Are you speak like Jiddu Krishnamurti, which nobody understands? Jiddu Krishnamurti, 60 years, at the age of 29, 30, they say he is enlightened. Since that time, I think 91, 92 years old. Until that time, he traveled all over the world, has been speaking. And in his last, I think I wanted to see him, because that was the time he stopped. Whenever he comes to India, he speaks generally in these big four cities. Shankara Pithas were in four corners of the country. Now the British Pithas are in the four corners of the country. Madras, Bombay, Delhi, Calcutta. These are the British Pithas. Okay. That's why these four are the first westernized, first anti-Hindu culture, these first four are. Because these are established by Britishers. Four British Pitha. Okay, I use very odd language for you. I use very, very sarcastic language. Okay, these are the four British Pithas. So he would give anybody who comes from abroad, first they visit these four British Pithas. So he also would deliver his lectures in these four Pithas and probably few cities like Bangalore, sometimes in Hyderabad, I don't know. So his dates were fixed, he was to come to Delhi, I was in Rishikesh. So I came to know in advance that he is coming to Delhi, then I planned and everything that I must go and at least listen to one talk directly. I read his books, but I wanted to listen to him directly. In those days, no audio, video, there were all cassettes, video cassettes were very costly and even video players were not available. Very rarely rich people would have. Nowadays anybody can get it, in cell phone you'll get it, you'll find plenty in YouTube you'll get plenty. So I wanted to listen to him directly. I read a few books. And he was in Madras. That is the time he fell sick. And he was taken away to America. That's all. That is the last. He never came again. And I am told, they say, in his last days, he shouted with his own intimate people who lived with him 30-40 years. 30-40 years they lived with close to him. I am told he shouted at them, "None of you have understood. None of you have understood. You have been around me. You have been interacting with me. You have never understood anything. None of you have understood." I am told he just shouted at them in his last days. And you know my sarcastic way of telling. Very caustic remarks. If nobody has understood, nobody is to be blamed for this except himself. Isn't it? You read his books. If nobody has understood, nobody can be blamed except himself. Because he made himself ununderstandable to anybody. Because he doesn't give up his ground. Doesn't compromise his stand. Doesn't help anybody. Andartha. Nobody can understand what he says. He snubbed the people in such a way that everybody who came with his enthusiasm in the beginning became disappointed. They have become simple listeners, one-way traffic radio station. Nowadays TV station also you can say. YouTube you can't say because at least you have got an option to comment there. In YouTube you can comment. In Facebook you can comment. But in radio, TV you can't comment. You only have to listen. So here, you have to, what is a universal fact you have to see. So you went all over there and it doesn't work because it doesn't help anybody. So, and then he also would talk like he says we should not be conditioned, we should be open and all that. He also says same thing. What is that? Man came from the monkey and all that, human being was like this in civilization developed all. What proof is there for that? Has he seen that? There also he goes by those Western ideas. Anyway, he didn't read books, didn't discuss with people. Without discussing, he dismissed everything. Any person who studies Vedanta all over the world, everybody knows Vedanta is such a open, there is nobody who is open, more open than Vedanta. and it dismisses Vedanta. Then you can see his prejudice, his closed mind. Okay. The person is incapable of understanding Vedanta and he wants to teach the society. So you only become utter failure. I think if there is a 100% failure on earth, I think you can say Jiddu Krishnamurti. 100% failure. He added confusion to people than clarity. He added, you talk to his followers, it is very interesting. You talk to his followers, they all dress up like him. That pyjama or some kind of a coat, they dress up like him. They talk exactly like him. They repeat his words. I used to meet him, when I was a brahmachari, I met them. They talk exactly like them. Now you say, we are conditioned. They say, we are conditioned, we are not open, we are not seeing. Oh, I understand, this is exactly Jiddu Krishnamurti style. They are all imitators. I don't want to comment on people, but it's not my purpose to comment on people. I only want to say the openness. He talks of so much of openness, he himself is a highly conditioned fellow. Because he doesn't listen to anybody. You see in all his dialogues, in all his discussions, he never listens to anybody. He only talks from his angle. Only from his angle. That's all. He doesn't tolerate anybody speak, everything he condemns. He dismisses. So, we can't go by the majority of the people. If that is the case, then Jiddu Krishnamurti, what do we have to say? He's a failure because nobody has understood. If you go by the what you call statistics, then nobody has understood. Anyway, so here, Atma Anatma, Purapakshi says that it is natural. Even in that so-called naturalness, there is Adhyasa. What Shankaracharya says is, see, I know the consciousness. When you say consciousness is knowable, is a known, that is Adhyasa. Okay. So we were discussing in the previous class yesterday, there is a misunderstanding between Atma and Anatma. When we say two, you are not seeing them two. You are seeing them already in a mixed condition. Okay. Then their qualities are also exchanged. What were the qualities we were discussing? I just repeat them and proceed. Okay, from today's talk. Consciousness, Chaitanyam is the nature of Atma, quality of Atma, property of Atma. Kutasthatvam, eternity. Vishayitvam, subjectness. Satyatvam, independent existence or existence itself, reality. Reality is the nature of Atma. Reality and existence are synonyms. Okay? Reality and existence. What exists is real. What is real is existing. What is unreal? It doesn't exist. Appears to exist but doesn't exist. See, this is the difference. So its existence is only apparent, not a real. Like a plastic mango. Appears to be mango, but it's not mango. Like a plastic orange. Appears to be orange, it's not orange. Similarly, appearance. What appears is not existing. What exists, exists. Okay. So, satyatvam is reality or existence. The nature of Atma is reality. It exists. Anatma appears but no existence of its own. Okay. Then sukha dukkha sansparsha vidhuratvam. It is free from experiences of sense organs and mind. Because sense perception, precept, we call them. Sense perception means precept. Shabdasparsha ruparasa gandha. Then mental precepts are emotions and feelings. Feelings and emotions. Feelings of pain and pleasure. And love and hatred. Emotions and emotional feelings. Feelings means includes everything. So, Atma is free from these feelings and perceptions. So, sukhadumka, sansparsha vidhuratvam. Vidhura means varjita. Niramshatvam. Atma has no amsha. Atma has no parts. Because its nature is uniform. Same nature, uniform nature. Ityevam. Anatma's nature is exactly opposite. Atma is chaitanyam, anatma is insentient. Okay. Then atma is kutastha, anatma is vikara, vikari. Kutastha means changeless. Anatma is changing. Changing means what? Two ways of changing. One is you change in time, you modify. Okay. One is modification. Another is move from place to place. You move from place to place. Another is aging. One is aging. Aging means it modifies. Another one also we can say, it can be looked from different angles. That comes under amshitvam. Okay. Vikara is only two. Let us take two only. Vikara two means it is changing and it is modifying. Okay. Then vishayatvam. It is always known. Anatma is always known to consciousness. Anatma can't know itself. It needs consciousness to be known. That means it exists only for consciousness. It doesn't exist for itself. Do you say the blue sky exists? The blue sky which we see, does it exist? It exists for whom? You go and touch there, you don't feel anything. You don't put your hand there. You see the inverted vessel, inverted plate, blue inverted plate, like a slightly dome shape. Glow, some kind of a, what you call, umbrella shape. A slightly bent like this. Slightly depression. Not so much depression like umbrella. A slight depression like this. A little. Now you see the blue round saucer. Saucer is a better example. Round saucer. Blue round saucer. It looks like that. Is it there? You go and touch it there. Nothing. So it appears, but you go and touch it, it doesn't exist. The blueness is a color. You go and feel there is no color. It only appears. Of course, the scientists give different explanation. We don't go into those details. We simply say it is appearance. The sky looks as if going touching the earth. That is a horizon. Horizon is a point, as we know, as we all know naturally, that the earth is touching, the sky is touching the earth. The sky touching the earth, that point is called horizon. Now, is there a horizon? No, I am seeing it. Okay, you see it, not only you see, I see, everybody sees. We all see it every day, we see them. Thousand times we see them. Everybody sees universally. But I am asking, is it there? It appears without being there. That is mithya. Anrutam means what? Mithyatvam. It appears but doesn't exist. Vishaya means it always appears to consciousness. It doesn't have consciousness of its own. Neither it knows itself nor it knows others. In fact, it is the consciousness alone has to establish that it is there. Like blue sky has no existence for itself. It exists for me. It doesn't exist for itself. The ghost. Children are afraid of ghost. Some people, elderly people also. Okay. Children are afraid of ghost. Is there a ghost which frightens? In order to frighten, is there a ghost? If it exists for the thought alone. It exists. That means it is only your feeling. That's all. Other than feeling, it has no existence. Just a feeling. Similarly, there is a bhuta preta, our shastras say. That is also different. We are talking of two bhutas. One bhuta which is purely imagination, out of fear. Another bhuta is really there. That is all. Another bhuta is jivas like us, jivas without body. Because modern science and modern education says all living beings are only with the body alone. But our shastra says living beings are of two types, with body, without body. With human body, with animal body. And there are the same jivas can exist without body because they will be toggling, fluctuating between body and no body. So sometimes they remain without body, sometimes they assume the body like ours. Okay. So we ourselves will become one day without bodies, unembodied. Now we are in embodied condition. Okay. Sasharira. Sasharira is embodied. Asharira, unembodied. At one time we were unembodied. Now we are bodied. After some time we will become unembodied. So our Shastra accepts that the same jiva who is in embodiment, he remains without embodiment, without body. So the jivas who remain without body, they go around all the time. You can see devas and pitrus, deva, pitru, bhuta, peta, they have been moving around. Since they don't have the body, we don't see them. Once in a while, they express themselves through some event. Either through event or through some kind of... Sometimes they appear in a human form also. Therefore, we call them ghosts. But they haven't appeared. Anyway, you leave them. So here, because when I say ghost is an imagination, we are using it for Vedantic purpose. There is another kind of ghost that is purely imagination. Out of fear you imagine. I am giving that as an example. Other ghost I am not touching. The real ghost I am not touching. The only imagined ghost alone I am giving as an example for Vedanta. So it is not there, but your mind feels. Similarly, you feel, dream you feel that it is there, but it doesn't exist. Similarly, anatma is mithya. This is very important. Anatma appears. Throughout it appears. Appears means it is perceived and conceived. It appears to sense organs as well as mind. Not one sense organ. We think generally appearance means only one sense organ. Only to the eye. Even if you feel, even if you can touch and feel, it is also appearance alone. Because for all five sense organs, for all, because sense of touch also is misleading, illusory, do you know? Sometimes forms can be illusory. The form appears to be there, but it is not there. Sometimes the sound also, you hear a sound. Sometimes you feel somebody called you. They come, you come and ask them, hey, Swamiji, have you called me? Swamiji, you called me for what? Yen Swamiji, yen karididdiri, they say. Swamiji, have you called me? What is the point? What is the matter? He says, no, I have not called you. No, Swamiji, you have called me really. No, I have not called you. I said, when I have not called you, I didn't even speak. How did you hear my voice? He heard it. Now, what do you say? Hearing also appears. Sight also appears. Touch also. You feel a touch. You feel somebody touching you from behind. Sometimes you feel that somebody touched you. You look behind, who is he? You turn around, see, there is nobody. But you feel that somebody has touched you. Therefore, touching can be illusory. Sounds can be illusory. Form can be illusory. Taste can be illusory. Smell also. You suddenly feel some mad smell. Some good smell. You ask, what is this? I am feeling some good smell. Are there any flowers? Are there any flowers? You ask. They say, no, no flower. Look around. Some agarbatti smell, I am feeling it. You go, there is nothing. Is there any put it? You search all over. There is no agarbatti. Then how did you feel? You felt it. Taste also, you feel suddenly, but there is nothing. So all five sense organs perceive without being there. The things without being there, you perceive them. Therefore, anatma is same atma, taken to be something other than atma. Anatma is not an entity, okay? Anatma itself is not an existing entity. Anatma taken as something. Which something? The something is not there, but you feel it. See, if anatma is not there, how are we doing? That's what it means. Anatma is not there. Atma alone is. When atma mistaken, in that mistaken condition, mistaken thought, mistaken feeling alone is anatma. Anatma itself doesn't exist. Then what is the moolam? What is the original nature of anatma? Atma is the original nature of anatma. See, its original nature is atma. But atma appears to be anatma. Anatma means something other than consciousness. Okay. Something other than consciousness. But it doesn't exist. It only appears. Okay. Anatma only appears to exist but doesn't, without existing. Without existing, appears to exist. Okay, mithyatma. Sukadukkatma katvam. Because anatma alone, you will have, anatma means mind, experiences. All experiences of sense organs, experiences of emotion, that is the mind, experiences of intellect. All this, these are the three mainly, you can say broadly, these are the three kinds of experiences. In all these experiences, you will have a convenient, inconvenient. Favorable experience, unfavorable experience. Sukha dukkha. What is sukha dukkha? Favorable, unfavorable. But Atma Chaitanyam doesn't have any favorable, unfavorable experience. Consciousness doesn't get into moods. Sometimes, do you ever feel your consciousness is favorable? Sometimes your consciousness is boring. I don't want consciousness. Do you ever say that? That's impossible. Consciousness doesn't have the two states of some kind of a pleasant state, some kind of unpleasant state. sometimes a favorable state, sometimes unfavorable state. Sometimes in a good mood and sometimes in a not so good mood. Consciousness doesn't have moods. Consciousness doesn't have states. It is uniform and pleasant and happy, that's all. It doesn't feel any deficiency. It doesn't feel any missing. Okay, it's always one and happy and relaxed and peaceful. So it is anatma alone has got this pleasant, unpleasant, favorable, unfavorable, agreeing, disagreeing. Agreeing means ishtavada, which agrees to your heart, means you are desirable, appealing to you. Agreeing means appealing, appealing, unappealing. Okay, agreeing, disagreeing means appealing, unappealing. It appeals to your heart. It touches your heart. Another thing is, it disturbs your heart. It makes you uncomfortable. Okay? Therefore, appealing and unappealing experiences. This is the nature of anatma. Every anatma you take them, every object, shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha, body, mind, intellect, sense organ, world, sometimes you like it, sometimes you don't like it. Sometimes it is pleasant, sometimes it is unpleasant. So, anatma has got these moods. These fluctuations. Atma doesn't have this. Atma has got one uniform, nice feeling of happy and comfortable. Always pleasant and nice feeling, because the nature of consciousness is ananda. Okay. Sukadukka atmakatvam. Last point of anatma is samsha. Anatma has got many aspects, many facets, multifaceted. It can be looked from different angle. In each angle it looks differently. See, this looks pen. You keep it a few yards away, it looks like a small piece like this. The mountain looks like small. The aeroplane looks very small of this size. The small one you put under microscope looks very big. Do you see the bacteria which they call them? Minute one which cannot be seen with eyes under the microscope, it looks so big. So, the same object looks different from different angles. That means its appearance keeps shifting and changing. Now, you cannot define nature of a particular object. See, what is this when you say? You cannot see this object completely. This has got one aspect. This one. This another, this another, this another, this another. It has got four and two, six facets, six aspects. Now, can you see this object completely? You can't see them. You see this aspect, this you are missing. You see this, the other one is missing. One side you see, the other one is lost. You see all these various things in your mind, your imagination you construct. But you can't see it directly. You can't see it directly, you can only construct it in your mind. Okay? And that also, the same object, you see closely, it looks one thing. You keep it far away, it looks different. That means the distance makes it appear differently. Light also, you put it in light, it looks bright and shiny. See? Even this black stone is reflecting the light. Bah! Surprising. Even the black stone is reflecting light, because once it is polished, it reflects light. Even a black stone. So, that means you put in the light in one way, in dim light in another way, in bright light in another way, medium light in another way. You put at a distance in another way. That means, object doesn't have any fixed nature. It appears in a particular way, in a particular context. You keep on shifting the context, keep on shifting the standpoint, it keeps on appearing differently. Okay. Therefore, no object has got a fixed nature. It keeps on, it has got a different aspects, different shapes, different ways of appearing, different ways of, the same thing. You mix with one thing while eating, supposing, an eatable object. You mix with milk, it tastes differently and also it affects on your body in one way. You mix with buttermilk, differently it affects. You mix with honey, affects differently. So, each object in your combination, it affects differently. So, you don't know what exactly is the object. That means it has got samshatvam. The whole prapancha is samsha. Whole prapancha is multifaceted. Every object in the world is multifaceted. You don't have a final word about any given thing on the earth. Everything looks differently. Even the scientist, when you break it, they told earlier there was only atoms for the last. Beyond atoms, it couldn't be further divided. Atom is indivisible. This is what we studied. In our younger days, atom is indivisible. Later, he told that there is one first person. I forgot the scientist. The first person came, he discovered that atom could be divided. Oh, he became the first scientist. Then atom is divided, then electrons, protons and neutrons. I heard it yesterday, our Brahmachari was telling. B.M. Hegde's talk, he was listening, he says, even the electron proton can be divided into 16 parts. I am told the 16 constituents. My God, you don't know what is what. Yesterday only, our Brahmachari, after listening, he sent me, I did not listen to it. He also sent me the link. He asked me to listen. B.M. Hegde says that it could be further divided. Then he end, if you get an instrument can divide electrons and protons, it could be divided further. And that could be divided further. You each time discover a new microscope, a much more powerful microscope, 1,000 times magnification. Or even a 10,000 time magnification. I tell you, the present bacteria looks like a Himalayan mountain. Okay? If you discover a 10,000 magnification, the smallest bacteria, amoeba, looks like a huge Himalayan mountain. So, what is what, we don't know. All these things appear in a given context. Change the context, appears differently. That means, you cannot say anything. That's why our post-Shankarites told, Jagat is anirvachaniya. Anirvachaniya means inexplicable. It cannot be defined as a something fixed as this. This and this alone. Because what you say this is only a given condition. Change the condition, it looks different. Again change the condition, it looks different. That means each condition, it keeps on changing, different. It looks a 1,000 different ways. Then out of them, which is its nature? Cannot be told. Anatma has got 1,000 different appearances. See how beautiful our Vedanta says. They have studied all this thoroughly. Our Vedantins are amazing people, I think incomparable on the earth. So, Amshitvam. Anatma is Samshatvam. Anatma has no multiple facets. Anatma cannot appear in different way. Atma. Chaitanya Atma cannot appear in different ways. Chaitanya Atma is of one nature, uniform, one and no differences. Anatma has all differences, so much of variety that it doesn't have any fixed nature. Anatma doesn't have a fixed nature, it has got many aspects and many changing aspects, many changing appearances. Atma has got only one and nothing but one, all uniformly one. Now this is a totally opposite nature. Okay. Now go, proceed with this thing. Ityeva madaya amisham dharmanam avivekaha. Now what is aviveka? We have explained what is dharmi. Atma is a dharmi, anatma is a dharmi. Now next we have explained atma's properties, anatma's properties. Now we have to explain aviveka. Aviveka between them means mixing between them. Intermixing, interchanging. Mixing means interchanging, that is better. Interchanging, exchanging, interchanging, whatever you say. What is aviveka? Aviveka means interchanging, exchanging the properties of atma and anatma, exchanging their identity. I think that exchange is a, anyonya adhyasa is a very Sanskrit technical term. Modern English term easily understandable is mutual exchange. Mutually exchanging. Interconnecting, taking this as a that as this. Asya dharmino ime dharmaha iti nirdharana abhavaha soyam aviveko adhyase nimittam. So, we have not seen the atma's nature as purely atma, anatma's nature as separately anatma. Because when we see them, atma seem to have anatma qualities, anatma features, anatma seem to have atma features. This is how our experience has been. This is the aviveka condition. In this aviveka condition, you find this superimposition. This is adhyasa. Okay. Now we have to say more things. We'll go little slowly. Because this is a very deeper topic. every point has to be very clear. We'll go slowly. Now I have changed my timings from 8:30 to 9:30 because it is, first thing is, it is convenient to me, my health and others, and some people expressed it is convenient to them from 11 to 12. I hope it will be convenient to you also. In few days you will adjust it, 11 to 12, because early morning some people say we cannot finish off all our daily routine and be prepared for 8:30. Then I change it, 11 is good. So I have got my strain, I have got another extra class, our Brahmachari, which I have been giving before, now he comes again. So I have to give him. So four classes is too much taxing on my throat, vocal cords. So we have 11 to 12 this Sugama class, 4 to 5 our, Vishuddha Vedanta Sara. Only two is enough, and you do manana, and then when God gives me time, gives us more time, and we'll listen more. But until then, we'll listen to two talks alone at the moment. Okay, Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Sri Guru Bhyo Namahan. Harihi Om Tat.